Someday I will have 100 more mothers than I do now. I will enjoy a forever family better than the nuclear family. I will enjoy my wife more deeply than I do now, yet without marriage and without sex. And my joy will not be building up my own kingdom to call my own, in becoming a god, or in having my own spirit children worship me as their god. No, my forever family's greatest joy will be dwelling with Heavenly Father and Jesus Christ. Listen to Jesus. He reorients the forever family around those who do the will of the Father. Matthew 12, here he points to his disciples. Here are my mother and my brothers. Whoever does the will of my Father in heaven is my brother and sister and mother. Jesus demands from you an allegiance over your family to himself and promises a new family that is 100-fold bigger and better. Mark 10, 29, truly I say to you, there is no one who has left house or brothers or sisters or mother or father or children or lands for my sake and for the gospel who will not receive 100-fold now in this time houses and brothers and sisters and mothers and children and lands with persecutions, and in the age to come, eternal life. This is staggering. Jesus promises 100-fold mothers to those who give up family in this life for his sake. The nuclear family unit isn't big enough to account for the forever family that I will have in Christ. Jesus esteems the life of a celibate single person for the sake of the kingdom as a completely legitimate path. Jesus is asked about divorce. He gives a really strict and high ethic about marriage and divorce. And his disciples reply by saying, if such is the case of a man with his wife, it's better not to marry. And Jesus responds, not everyone can receive this saying, but only to those to whom it is given. There are eunuchs who have made themselves eunuchs for the sake of the kingdom of heaven. Paul teaches to live properly in our present circumstances, yet in anticipation of no longer being married. He says, for now on, let those who have wives live as though they have none. For the present form of this world is passing away. In the same chapter, he counsels his people in Corinth to stay single if they can, if possible, to have single-minded devotion to Jesus Christ. Jesus teaches that there will be no marriage in the resurrection. He says, as he's confronted by the Sadducees, with a scenario, there's a lady who has a succession of 7 husbands, each dies. The joke is she's a really bad cook, but they're all dead, and they ask Jesus, which one will she be married to in the resurrection? And Jesus replies, you are wrong, because you know neither the scriptures nor the power of God. For in the resurrection, they neither marry nor are given in marriage, but are like the angels in heaven. Robert Bowman comments, the issue Jesus was discussing with the Sadducees was not when marriages would be performed, but to whom individuals married to more than one spouse in this life would be married to in the next. If we understand Jesus to be saying only that the time to perform marriages is in this life, then he didn't answer the Sadducees' question at all. So, this isn't about the urgency of getting celestially married in this life. This is about the resurrection power of God to transform human existence into something better, even better than marriage. Christians, we don't have any reason to have any anxiety over relationships and connections with people in the resurrection. Paul says, he says to the Corinthian community who had tribalistic issues, he said, let no one boast in men. For all things are yours, whether Paul or Apollos or Cephas or the world or life or death or the present or the future, all are yours. And you are Christ, and Christ is God's. So no FOMO, no fear of missing out. It's all mine in Christ Jesus. Jesus says there, he is going to prepare a place for me to bring me back to where he is. It's not a game. It's not a YouTube stunt. This is theology. Jesus says, in my Father's house are many rooms. The point here is spaciousness, not separation. He says, if it were not so, would I have told you that I go to prepare a place for you? And if I go to prepare a place for you, I will come again and take you to myself, that where I am, you may be also. Jesus isn't threatening his disciples with the prospect of living in a separate kingdom that he may or may not occasionally visit. He is preparing rooms that are in the singular Father's house that are where the Father and the Son are and that are with all the believers. Jeffrey R. Holland says in an LDS Temple open house video, quote, "I don't know how to speak of heaven in the traditional, lovely, paradisiacal beauty that we speak of heaven. I wouldn't know how to speak of heaven without my wife, my children. It would not be heaven for me." Let me contrast this with a story. When my wife and I moved to Orem, we lived in a basement apartment, and the host invited a BYU professor in the local ward to come over. And I asked him about Joseph Smith's sexual relationships with some of his plural wives, and he agreed to it, that it happened. And then he looked at my wife at one point, and he said, "There she is, she's out right here, Stacy." He looked at my wife, and he said, "Don't you want to be married to your husband forever?" And she said, "No." "I won't need to be. I will be with Christ." And I wanted to kiss her. I knew exactly what she meant. My wife doesn't depend on me for her eternal happiness in Christ. Neither do I her. We can both say together to Christ in Psalm 73, "Whom am I in heaven but you? And there is nothing on earth that I desire besides you." My wife and I can say forever together with David in Psalm 16, "You are my Lord, and I have no good apart from you. As for the saints in the land, they are the excellent ones in whom is all my delight. In your presence is fullness of joy. At your right hand are pleasures forevermore." My wife and I forever can say with David in Psalm 23, to Christ, "Surely goodness and mercy will follow me all the days of my life, and I shall dwell in the house of the Lord forever."